So this morning, I haven't preached yet. That was free. So some of y'all say, I don't like free stuff. Okay, all right, we'll move on. Luke 4, 31 through 37. Now, many of us recognize Jesus as a Savior, but I want to present to you this morning that Jesus is a destroyer. Now, those of y'all that would like to leave because you think I'm preaching heresy, you can do that right now. But I will give you biblical support to my belief that Jesus is a destroyer. And the title of this message is, He Came to Destroy. In Luke 4, 31, 37, and He went down to Capernaum, a city of Galilee, and He was teaching them on the Sabbath, and they were astonished at His teaching, for His word possessed authority. And in the synagogue there was a man who had the spirit of an unclean demon, and he cried out with a loud voice. Now, I will say this, let me pause here. This man with the unclean demon had been going to synagogue for years. Right? Only, he never exposed himself. What caused him to expose himself? Well, earlier on in Luke 4, 18 and 19, Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. When Jesus showed up, the Word of God, empowered by the Spirit of God, the presence of God, began to cause those demons to stir. Right? What I'm trying to get you to realize is that you can go to church and be in church, but if the presence of God is not moving, then you're going to be in the same situation that you were in before you came to church. It's God's Word in partnership with the Spirit that begins to make a difference in our churches. Just having a church, calling it a church, gathering together is not enough. We need the presence of God in our midst to move. Amen? So anyway, there was a man who had a spirit of an unclean demon, and because the presence of God was there, we know, because Jesus was there, right? He began to cry out, and he said, Ha! What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God. But Jesus rebuked him, saying, Be silent and come out of him. And when the demon had thrown him down in their midst, he came out of him, having done him no harm. And they were all amazed and said to one another, What is this word? For with authority and power he commands the unclean spirits, and they come out. And reports about him went out into every place in the surrounding region. Just kind of give you a little background where we're looking at here. After the Holy Spirit descended upon Jesus, when he was baptized by John, the Spirit came upon him in the form of a dove. The Bible says that Jesus, full of the Spirit, was led out into the wilderness to be tempted of the enemy. And he came out of those 40 days of temptation victorious. And he came out not just full of the Spirit, but he came out in the power of the Spirit. And when he came out in the power of the Spirit, Matthew says he went all around the surrounding countryside, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom, and healing every form of sickness and every form of disease. In the book that we're reading, in the book of Luke, he went into the city of Nazareth, and when he had come out of Nazareth, he wasn't well received in Nazareth. When he came out of Nazareth, the city where he was raised, having been rejected there, he then goes to Capernaum, and on the Sabbath, which is where our text is, he goes into the synagogue. In this text, Jesus is in the synagogue teaching when a man who had a spirit of an unclean demon cries out, What have you come to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Question. He continued on by what our text translates as another question. Have you come to destroy us? Well, I don't know if you know very much about the Bible, but originally the Bible was not written with quotation marks and punctuation marks, and it wasn't written with any of that. It was actually written in uncial letters, I mean like capital letters, and it was written one letter after the other, and so you had to determine where what punctuation and where punctuation should be put in the text whenever you're translating it from one language to another, if you want to understand the meaning. Okay? And let me give you another example. Hebrew is the same way. Hebrew is written without vowels. And so people that understand Hebrew and read Hebrew, when they're reading through the words, they have to add their own vowels to be able to make meaning to the word. So we have to, in some way, be able to add punctuation marks. And whether you realize it or not, there was no chapter 5, verse 1 in the original letters. There was no heading that said, these are the first disciples, or this is the temptation of Jesus. None of that was in the original letters. There was no capital or separation for paragraphs. None of that was in the original letters. Now, why don't I bring that out? Because this interpreted as a question is probably a very reasonable interpretation, but I just want to give you another opportunity or another option here, that there's a possibility that it wasn't really a question. It could be translated in another way, and it could be translated as a statement. For instance, he said, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth?" And then as a statement, they go on and say, "You have come to destroy us." In other words, they're answering their own question. What have you come to do with us? You've come to destroy us, right? Now, why is this important? Well, either way, whether as a question or as a statement, it brings out the fact that Jesus' mission in coming was more than just to forgive people of their sins. Now, that is important. We're not saying that's not a reason for why he went to the cross, to forgive people of their sins. That is important. It is central to the gospel, and we're never going to lay that aside. But Jesus didn't just come to forgive people of their sins. He came to make a public spectacle of the enemy of people. He came to destroy the work of the devil, right? It was summarized very well in this statement that the demon said. He said, "You have come to destroy us." In fact, if I were to run down to another place, and we'll do that here in a minute, Scripture will actually bear that out. But before I get there and moving forward, I want to show you that Scripture bears out Jesus' mission was and is to destroy the works of the devil. Second, I want to look into what it actually means that Jesus destroyed the works of the devil. How did he go about doing that? And third, I want to focus on the importance of that mission that Jesus had and what it means to you and I. Okay? So, the first thing, I try to use some words that are similar. If I don't use all words that begin with the same letter, they'll begin with the same idea. But anyway, in this one, the first point I want to look at is Jesus' mission expressed. In 1 John 3:8, it says, "Whoever makes a practice of sinning is of the devil, for the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The reason," now this is Scripture, "the reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the works of the devil." Remember, what did I title the message? He came to destroy. But it's important that we understand what he came to destroy. He came to destroy the works of the devil. Now, behind the scenes of this world, we were talking about the prophetic a little bit earlier. One of the things that a prophetic is able to do, a prophetic person, the prophetic gifting is able to see beyond what you see in the natural. All right? What is God's will for our life? Seeing can also be perceiving. You can perceive things spiritually, but you can also see. There are people that have the gift of being able to see supernaturally. They can see angels. They can see the spiritual beings behind the scenes. They can see the workings of God, and that's part of God's desire for God's people, that we would be able to hear what the Spirit is saying, but we can also, many of us, can see or perceive what the Spirit is saying. Jesus said it this way, "I hear what my Father is saying and I say it. I see what my Father is doing and I do it." Behind the scenes of the world that we live in is a spiritual realm that many people live in ignorance of. Not you, but maybe the person next to you. Don't look at them just in case. They don't want you to know that you think that about them. But there is a spiritual realm that many people live in ignorance of. But there is a host of beings in this realm. Not only is there the Lord and the angels of God, but there's also a host of beings led by a malevolent ruler, a bad person. He's got a bad nature, wicked nature, and he is bent on, along with the people that are following him, on destroying the creation of God. They are bent on destroying God's crowning creation, and that's you and I. Like the Pharaoh in the land of Egypt, his purpose is to keep the people of God in slavery in order to accomplish his purpose in building up his domain, his rule, his kingdom. It says in 1 John 5:19, "We know that we are from God, and the whole world lies in the power of the evil one." All right? So, John is letting you know that this is the reality. He's not saying this is God's purpose. He's not saying this is God's will. He is saying this post-cross, post-victory, and we'll get into that here in a minute, but the reality is that victory has not spread throughout the world. There is still an evil person that is trying to rule and run the puppet strings of this world, okay? Again, as John said, the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. However, like Moses, whom God used to deliver the Israelites from the land of Egypt and destroy the powers of Egypt, God sends His own Son into the world to do a similar thing that Moses did. Moses is a type of what Jesus would later do. In Deuteronomy 18 and 15, Moses actually said, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from our brothers, and it is to him you shall listen." By the way, Jesus is the fulfillment of this prophetic word that was given to Moses, and it is Jesus to whom we should listen, because He is the Lord. That is His name. That is His title. He is the Lord. And what do lords demand? That we obey them, submit to them. He doesn't make us do it, but everyone will do it in one day. The privilege for those who bow down to Him out of their own free will, out of love for Him, the privilege for us is that we then get to spend eternity with Him because we experience the salvation of God. Am I making sense to you? But one day, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that He is Lord. And His purpose is to save His people by destroying the powers of this invisible kingdom, that the people of God might be delivered and set free from the oppression of Satan's rule. You remember Moses went in and he destroyed the powers of Egypt. How? Signed 10 plagues that came upon Egypt. The last plague brought the people out. The blood was placed on the doorpost. The lamb was eaten by the people of God. They came out, had a great Passover, and the people of God were delivered from the land of Egypt. Jesus came to do the same thing. He came to deliver the people of God from the bondage to the enemy. He came to break the power of His rule. It says in Hebrews 2, 14 through 15, "Since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, He Himself likewise partook of the same things, that through death He might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery." Are you getting where I'm going here? Now, let me just sum this up by the passage in Colossians 2, 13 through 15 that says this, "And you," he's talking about to all those that are Christians, "who were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your life, God made alive together with Him, with Jesus, having forgiven us all our trespasses by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands." You see, it's not just sin. Sin had its legal demands. The enemy had legal right to us until Jesus came and dealt with the legal demands. He fulfilled everything that was required in the law for our purposes, for our behalf. Not for Him, He was sinless. But He who knew no sin became sin for us that we might eventually become the righteousness of God in Christ. He took our robe of sin, placed it upon Him, which is why He went to the cross. But because He went to the cross, when He resurrected, we then have the privilege of wearing His robe of righteousness. Amen? We talked about that whenever the prodigal came back. Joyce was talking, when the prodigal came back, the Bible says that the father said, "Bring out the best robe and put it on my son." When we come back to God, when we come back to the Lord, He puts upon us a robe of righteousness that we wear always in His presence. It's not one that we earned. It's one that was given to us by the mercy and the grace of God that was won through us through the victory at the cross of Calvary. Am I making sense to you? Okay? It says, "By canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands, this He set aside, nailing it to the cross." And here's where I'm going. He disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them in Him. Now, what you need to realize, what this is kind of referring to, is in Roman times, whenever the Romans would win a victory over an army, over a nation, they would take the leading people of the nation, including the king or whoever it was, and they would bring them in triumphal procession back to Rome, and they would be led into Rome in a in a line bound and made a public spectacle of before the city. That is what Jesus did to the enemy of our souls, is he disarmed them, won a victory over them, triumphed over them, and made a public spectacle of them in Christ. I'm preaching a lot better than your amening. I want you to know that is good news. Because he did come to forgive us of our sins, but the reason he forgave us of our sins is because he destroyed the power of the enemy. Amen? So that's Jesus' message. What did I put there? Explain. What's that first point? Jesus' message expressed. Second point I want to bring out is Jesus' message expounded. So let's expound on that work. How did Jesus go about destroying the works of the devil? Many at this time were expecting the Messiah to come. The Pharisees were expecting, the Sadducees were expecting, the people were expecting a Messiah to come, but they didn't expect him to come as an infant born in a manger. They were expecting him to come as a conquering king that would come in and destroy the military might of Rome, who were the oppressors of Israel. He would, in their minds, be a visible king and a conquering ruler. And what the people didn't understand is that Rome was not the real enemy. Rome was the visible enemy. But Ephesians 6:10 through 12 says, "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against authorities, against cosmic powers." And he's not talking about presidents and senators and congressmen. He's talking about the administration, the government, the military array of the enemy. They also have administrations. They have ways. The way the enemy works is the way our visible government works. You have a head, you have places of authority under which you have the head of the chief of staff, and then you have the military, the Pentagon, and then you have the Department of Housing. And so you have these structures that are in place that are underneath the top structure, and then under them you have the people that carry out the will of those superiors, who carry out the will of its superior. And so it's describing to you the way that the enemy works. He says, "We do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against rulers, and then those that are under them, against authorities, and then those that are under them, against the cosmic of powers over this present darkness, and those that are under them, under the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly places." So Paul is making us aware of the fact that we don't wrestle with people. We don't wrestle with Democrats and Republicans. We wrestle with the enemy that's behind that. Am I making sense to you? So how would Jesus' mission to destroy the works of the real enemy then be accomplished? We have the answer in the verses in Luke, and I was referring to this just a little bit ago, but I didn't read it to you yet. He was anointed by the Spirit of God. It says in Luke 14:4, 18, and 19, Jesus said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me." Now, I want you to know that this is why the Christmas season is so important. Because the Bible says, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." The wages of sin is death. Whenever Adam and Eve sin, all of us who are included in Adam are now experiencing the derogatory effects of sin. Because of sin, the presence of God and the Spirit of God that resided in us and with us, we were separated from at the Garden of Eden. We were talking about this morning. So, whenever we are born, we're not born in connection to the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God is not resident in us. We have a spirit. But when we get saved, the Spirit of God takes up residence in us. So what that tells you is that until we get saved, we're walking in absence of the relationship that we used to have with God. The Spirit of God is not in us, and certainly the Spirit of God is not upon us. Am I making sense to you? Okay? So what made Jesus different, and the reason that it's important that Jesus was born of a virgin, he was totally human, 100% flesh, but he had the DNA of heaven, which means he was sinless. Right? Because he was sinless, he was never out of contact with the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God lived in him. And not only that, this person in whom the Spirit of God resided also was baptized in water. And the Bible says that the Spirit of God came upon him. Now, Jesus, everything he did in this earthly realm, he didn't do as God. Philippians 2 says he left his godhood, his deity aside. He functioned as a man in connection, in relationship with his Father, empowered by the Spirit of God. And Jesus says, the Spirit of God is upon me. Why? Because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of God's favor. And the year of God's favor means jubilee. In the Old Testament mindset, every 7 years, I believe it's every 7 years, you would have a jubilee year, right? Is that correct? Or is it every 50 years? Okay, on the seventh year, there was a measure of jubilee, but on every 50th year, there was a jubilee year. And on that 50th year, everybody that was in debt could get their land back. Everybody that was enslaved, that was a part of the people of God, could get be set free and start over again. How many of y'all would like to start over again? Right? How many of you would like all your credit card debt to be erased? How many of you all would like all your student loan debt to be erased? Well, it's not going to happen because of socialism. It's not going to happen because of a liberal government. What is going to happen, and what we learn here, is because it's a moving of God in your life, God is able to minimize and erase all your past debts. I'm not talking about money. He can do that as well. I'm talking about the debt that we incurred because of being out of fellowship and relationship with God. Right? So anyway, he says, this is Jubilee year. Why? Because the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and through the means of the Spirit of God and empowered by the Spirit of God, here's how you're going to receive the blessings of God in your life. I'm going to proclaim through the Spirit of God good news to the poor. So if you're poor, good news. What is the good news? The Spirit of God on Jesus has been sent in cooperation with Jesus to set the poor free, to proclaim liberty to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of God's favor, to proclaim Jubilee. Luke summarizes Jesus' mission in another even more succinct way in the book of Acts, in Acts 10:38, where it says, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, and he went around doing good. How did he do good? Healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. So what was he doing? The Spirit of God in him, the Spirit of God upon him, is manifested through his life by destroying the works of the devil. How did he destroy the works of the devil? He healed the sick, raised the dead, cleansed the leper, set the captives free. Are you hearing what I'm saying? It's not just the proclamation, it's the proclamation and the doing. He didn't come just to inform you of good theology. He came and he practiced good theology. He said, God's word says, that the people will be set free, and then he went about manifesting the word of God. It was good word, but it was also good deed. He was good theology, but he was also good practice, because when he showed up, he wasn't just talking good words, good talking good freedom. He was setting people free. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Could somebody get me a bottle of water, tap water, please? It's all the heaters going on. It kind of wears on your vocal cords. Anyway. Jesus' mission to destroy the works of the devil, then, we've seen in Jesus' setting people free from their physical pains and bondages, as well as delivering them from their captors and tormentors through the power of the Spirit which rested upon him, as well as forgiving them of their sins. We don't want to forget that as well. Okay? Luke shows us Jesus in action throughout the gospel that he left us. In Luke 4, 38 through 41, it says, and he arose and left the synagogue and entered Simon's house. Simon's mother-in-law was ill with a high fever, and they appealed to him on her behalf. and he stood over her and rebuked the fever, and it left her, and immediately she arose and began to serve them. If you were to go to Matthew chapter 8, verse 17, it says, and it gave the scriptural justification for why he did this, because it says in Isaiah 53, it says, he carried our sick, surely he carried our sorrows, and he carried our griefs, and he bore our sorrows, something like that, okay? But then Matthew, through the Spirit of God, said, that's not the way to translate it. It's not the right way to interpret it. The right way to interpret it is this. He healed Peter's mother-in-law by rebuking the fever and healing her in order to give confirmation to the scripture that says, he carried our sicknesses and he bore our pains. By his stripes we are healed. So why was he healing people? Because he came to destroy the works of the devil. What are we trying to tell you? That God's desire and purpose is that people not be broken and sick and destroyed, just ravaged by life. He came to make people whole and to set people free. Now you might say to yourself, well, wait a minute, I've been a Christian for a long time and I still have hurts, I still have pains. We understand that. I'm not saying that that's not a reality, but that's not God's desire for your life. The will of God and the desires of God don't always get manifested. But I want to set the bar where God set the bar so that we set our bar in the same place. And we pursue His standards until we see His standards met or until He comes to get us. Am I making sense to you? Doug works at one of the plants out here. And we don't want to create a tension in the body because some people work for that plant and some people work for other plants. But Doug works for one of the plants out here, I'm just kidding, and he's a safety guy. Well, you know why they have a safety guy there? Because not everybody practices safety. But the bar is not lowered to what everybody does. The bar is set up here, and Doug's job is to try to get everybody knowledgeable of where the bar is and then getting them to practice until they meet the standards. Make sense to you? But somehow when it comes to the Lord and when it comes to Christianity and theology, we say my experience is not in line with the Word, so I want to lower the Word of God to my experience. No. God's Word, we need to know what the Word of God says. We need to be knowledgeable of what the Word of God says. And then together as a body, we need to start moving towards raising our standard till it meets His standard. Am I making sense to you? The Word of God is called the canon. The canon doesn't mean something you shoot. Doesn't mean that. It actually means a standard. This is God's standard. This is God's rule in life. This is God's commandments. This is God's instruction. And so that doesn't vary. Your words are forever settled in the heaven, the Word of God says. Jesus said, when we pray, pray this way, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. It's not our job to bring heaven down to our standards. It's our job to raise our standards up to His. Am I making sense to you? So anyway, the reason that Jesus rebuked this woman's fever and healed her was to come into agreement with His purpose and His mission in life, which is to destroy the works of the devil. The Bible says, when the sun was setting, all those who had any who were sick with various diseases brought them to Him, and He laid His hands on every one of them, and He healed them. And demons also came out of many, crying, you are the Son of God. But He rebuked them and would not allow them to speak because they knew He was the Christ. All right? It's kind of like you can be a false witness and still give a true statement. But the true statement is compromised because of the falsity of your witness. Am I making sense to you? So they were given a true statement, but they weren't good witnesses. So Jesus silenced them. But there were many other people throughout the Bible that got touched by Jesus, were healed by Jesus, that went about saying, He is the Son of God. He is the Savior of Israel. Jesus set people free from their sicknesses, their disease, their infirmity, and their affliction. And yes, ultimately, He set them free from what led them into their captivity, which was their sin. He did this through His ultimate sacrifice of Himself at the cross of Calvary. Where his work provided the means for all those whom would believe to be set free from the devil's clutches and works of oppression. Romans 5:18 and 19 says, therefore, just as one trespass led to condemnation for all men, so one act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all men. I like to look at it this way. One man's sin caused all the dominoes to fall down. One man's act of righteousness is that much greater because he causes the dominoes to raise back up again. Am I making sense to you? Romans 10 and 19, for as by one man's disobedience the many were made sinners, so by one man's obedience the many will be made righteous. They'll stand in the presence of God. Romans 10, 19, 9 and 13, because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Savior, Lord, and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. So anyway, that's Jesus' message expounded, but now I want to look at the category of Jesus' message extended. Now, why is this important? Why is it important for you and me? It's important because Scripture teaches that as Jesus was sent out into the world, so are we sent out into the world. Listen to what I'm saying. As Jesus was sent out into the world, so too are we sent out into the world. We're not sent into the churches. We are sent into the world. Jesus did go to synagogue, but most of the time he was rejected at the synagogue. But he was a very good synagogue goer, but his primary ministry was not in the synagogue. It was outside of the synagogue. Not because he couldn't do anything in the synagogue, but most of the time they didn't want him in the synagogue. Right? But sometimes we need to understand we're called to gather together with the gathering of the saints, but our primary mission is not to gather together with the saints. We gather together with the saints to huddle up and to determine how we're going to carry out our mission. But our mission is not in here. This is practice for what we're going to do out there. Just like when you go to boot camp, you don't go to boot camp so that you can function all your life in boot camp. You go to boot camp to teach you how to go to war in the world. Are you hearing what I'm saying? As Jesus was sent into the world, so are we sent into the world. Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil, and my contention is so are we to destroy the works of the devil. I'm going to let that say, this is a power pause. I'm going to take advantage of it and drink something. If that's the case, then that broadens the scope of the assignment that we, the church, have while we're on this planet. We are more than just seeking to get to heaven. I want to get to heaven. I want you to get to heaven. But we may be in jeopardy of getting to heaven if we don't accomplish our assignment. Heaven is our destination. It's not our assignment. Whenever Jesus gave talents to three different ones of his servants, the one that did nothing with what he was given was in danger. Are you hearing what I'm saying? We've been given much to what? To accomplish the will of our Master and our Lord, Jesus Christ. If we just take what we have and hide it and don't do anything with it, we think, well, I'm just waiting to get to heaven. Could it be that in waiting to get to heaven, we're not accomplishing the will of our Father and not accomplishing the will of our Lord? We're actually in danger of missing heaven. Are you hearing what I'm saying? You see, we've created theologies to justify our idleness and our laziness. We're not called to sit and wait for Jesus to come back. He is coming back. We're called to occupy. Occupy is a military term. Go out into the world and occupy until he comes. Be about doing the Master's business. Jesus said in John 17 and 18, as you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. Turn to somebody and say, he's talking to you. At the cross, when we appropriate what he did at the cross, he set us free and provided us the means to continue the mission that he championed. We too are to destroy the works of the devil. Only we're not seeking to attain a victory, but we're sent to enforce a victory. You read many stories of military victories. Today we have GPS, we have technology, we have phones, means of communication. But many times throughout the span of time, throughout history, you could have a ceasefire or a battle that determined victory over an enemy. And because of communication that was disrupted or communication that was delayed, you have people fighting a war that's already been won. Even back to World War I, you had people that were fighting a war 3 years later, even though the signature on the victory had already taken place 3 years prior, because they never heard the news. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Right? Why is that important? Well, Jesus won a victory at the cross of Calvary. But when he won the victory at the cross of Calvary, it doesn't mean that the enemy heard about it or he wants to obey it. We won the victory, but it's our job to enforce the victory. The battle is not over when you take the capital. Now you move from occupying to beginning to disseminate the victory that was won. You got to go in and you got to subdue any last remaining hostile forces. We've been sent into the world not to gain a victory. We've already won the victory at the cross of Calvary. We've been sent into the world to enforce a victory. But how can you enforce a victory that you don't know you won? How can you enforce a victory that you don't believe you've won? How can you enforce a victory that you don't believe you have authority and power to enforce? Are you hearing what I'm saying? Right? So just like the apostles who were sent out two by two, we also are sent out to proclaim the kingdom of God and heal all who are sick with the authority and power that Jesus bestowed upon us because of his victory at the cross. Luke 10 and 19, "Behold, I've given you authority to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you." Matthew 10, 7 and 8, "And he told the apostles, go proclaim as you say, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You receive without paying, give without pay." And you might say to yourself, "Well, I'm not an apostle." Doesn't matter. You're a believer. Mark 16 and 15 says, "These signs shall follow those who believe." Are you a believer? Yes. Same thing. You're going to preach the gospel. You're going to heal the sick. Making sense to you? Right? Okay, so our mission is to penetrate the darkest recesses of this planet and carry the good news of the kingdom and the victory that was won at the cross of Calvary and liberate all those that were oppressed of the enemy. Why? Because God is with you. Do you want to see the power of God manifest in your life? Then go out there and do the work of the kingdom and, just like Jesus, set the captives free. Another power pause. Again, Mark 16 and 15 says, Jesus said to them, "Go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. And these signs will accompany those who believe." That's you. That's me. I'm assuming that all of you here believe. "In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak in new tongues. They will pick up serpents with their hands. And if they drink any deadly poison, it will not hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover." Now, another way of saying this, another way of translating this, if you go to Matthew 18 and 19, most of us, 28, 18 and 19, most of us know that, "Go into all the world and make disciples of all nations." Well, actually, if you understood it the way it's supposed to be translated, or a more better way, that's good English, a more better way of translating this is, "As you go, make disciples of all nations." It doesn't say, "As you sit in the church, as you hide out in your homes." It doesn't say that. It says, "As you go." Go where? To my job, to the supermarket, to my school, to my places of gathering, to my Thanksgiving reunion, high school reunion, to the Thanksgiving gathering, to my Christmas. "As you go, make disciples of all nations." Going is not a command. Going is a given. Making disciples is the command. How do we make disciples? We proclaim the good news and we demonstrate the good news by healing the sick, raising the dead, cleansing the lepers, casting out devils. Well, I can't do that. You're absolutely right. You cannot do that. But God can. I love that story. Smith Wigglesworth came into a room. A person was, I think it was a girl that was totally riddled with demons, full of demons. And he comes in and she straightens up. She says, "You can't make me go." And he says, "Jesus can." And a couple of minutes later, those things were gone. We can't do it, but he can, right? Jesus said, how do we accomplish the mission? The same way that Jesus did. John 14, 15 through 17. "If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever." How long? Forever. "Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you. And he will be in you." When you got saved, what makes Christianity Christianity is not that you become a better person. It is that the Spirit of God takes up residence inside of you. God Almighty, the one who holds the universe in his hands, lives and took up residence in us. Imagine that. I love to watch these shows, How the Universe Works, and I like to watch the stars and the constellations. I like to look back and see what God created, see the galaxies, and there's not just one galaxy. There are billions of galaxies, and you can never even circumnavigate the one galaxy we live in, and yet there are billions, and they're ever expanding. And the Bible says that God holds the universe, not the galaxy, not the solar system, not our planet, but the universe in the palm of his hands. And just sit back and think about this, that God lives inside of you. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Is there anything too difficult for you? Nothing. "Even the Spirit of truth, who dwells within you." In Acts 1 and 8, it says, "You also," so you, if you're a Christian, the Spirit of God lives in you. But Jesus didn't just have the Spirit of God in him. The Spirit of God came upon him. And he said, "You also," he's talking to the believers, "will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you will be my witnesses." We tend to think, be my witnesses, you're going to pass out tracts. Yes, that's part of it. But I don't believe it's just passing out tracts. I believe, like John 14 and 12 says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do, and greater works than these shall I do." So in other words, we may come to somebody and we may give them a tract, we may tell them about Jesus, but we can also heal them of their sickness and heal them of their disease. When I say that, I'm not saying that you do it. I'm saying you become God's hand extended. You become the vessel of God. The Spirit of God rests upon you for a reason. Why? To preach good news to the poor, to cause recovery of sight to the blind, to set the captives free. You can see someone that's hurting. You can extend your hands and touch them and release the presence of God on their life and see the sick made whole, see the lepers cleansed, see the blind, see the deaf hear, the dead raised. Why? Because you understand that your mission is not just to go to church and listen to somebody else preach to you. Your mission is to carry out Jesus' mission that was won at the cross of Calvary, and to go into the world and destroy the works of the devil. Paul says, you might say to yourself, I'm not a great preacher, I'm not a great teacher, I can't do what you do, Pastor Rick, I can't even do what I do. It's the Spirit of the Lord helping me to do what I do. But we tend to think it's you need the gift of tongue or you need the gift of gab to be able to do what I do. That's not true. You ask my wife, she's a little frustrated with me because I speak so much on Sunday morning and I probably speak all that much the rest of the week. She wants me to talk. The reason I'm talking now is because the Spirit of the Lord's on my life, moving me. You say, well, I don't have that. Paul says, my message and my preaching were not in eloquent words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and power, so that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. 1 Corinthians 4:20, for the kingdom of God does not consist in talk, but in power. You shall receive power after the Holy Spirit comes upon you. 2 Corinthians 10:4 through 6, Paul says, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the destruction of strongholds. We destroy arguments, every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God, and take every thought captive to the obedience of Christ, being ready to punish every disobedience when your obedience is complete. Are you hearing what I'm saying? The Spirit of God, because of the work that Jesus did, not only took up residence inside of you, the Spirit of God rests upon you to do what? To do what Jesus did. Remember, he said, the Spirit of God is upon me for, to proclaim the good news to the poor. Set at liberty those who are oppressed. Open blinded eyes. Release the captives. To proclaim the acceptable year of God's favor. What did that look like? Jesus was full of the Holy Spirit and power, and he went around doing good, healing, which means also deliverance. If you look throughout, it's healing, is deliverance is including in healing, to set people free from their sickness, from their disease, from their tormentors, from their affliction. You can't sleep at night because there's an enemy that torments you. It's a spirit that's oppressing you. What do? You release the Spirit of God upon their life. You say, well, I don't know if I can do that. The Bible says to call for the elders of the church and let them lay hands on you, and the prayer of faith will heal the sick. The prayer of faith will deliver those that are oppressed. Are you hearing what I'm saying? The Spirit of God upon us enables us to do what we cannot do on our own. Jesus went to the cross of Calvary not just to get you to heaven, but to release the Spirit of God in your life and on your life so you could accomplish the mission that he was sent to do. One Christ, and look at what he did. Now, through the Spirit of God, many Christians in whom Christ dwells, going into the world, accomplishing the same mission. And that's why Jesus was able to say, and greater works than these shall you do. He didn't mean, hey, you're going to do something greater than raising the dead. He meant not greater in quality, but greater in quantity. Because now all of God's people potentially have the Spirit of God in them and the Spirit of God upon them to do what? To destroy the works of God.